let's just get into this because I have a lot to say today. We've been on this series of Why the Church and increasing our evangelistic efforts through sharing our faith and how to share your faith. And last week, Pastor Reggie began to talk about the marketplace anointing and using our influence in seven areas in our life: business, government, media, arts and entertainment, education, family, and religion. So today I'm going to take a little detour from that, but I believe what I have today will encourage us and help us receive what's to come in the series, but also reinforce what we've already been taught. Amen? Because something last week that Pastor Reggie said got my attention about how we're going to stay on this series of Why the Church until we actually see the fruit that we are proclaiming, amen? No matter how long it takes. And I started to think, why is this message taking a long time to take root and really produce the harvest and the fruit that we are desiring? You know, maybe you're like me. You know, I want everybody to be saved. I pray for people to be saved. I pray for people to receive salvation. But I have not necessarily seen it to the degree that we have been talking about. I haven't seen a degree like in the Church of Acts, where thousands and thousands daily are being added to the church. And I'm just speaking for myself. I'm like, what do I need to do? What do I need to do in order to effectively share my faith to that same degree? Because back then, back in the book of Acts, I mean, they didn't have any of the technological advancements that we have today. I mean, just think about it. Put it in context. They didn't have cars. They didn't have phones. They certainly have cell phones. They didn't have TVs. They didn't have even radios. They didn't have the internet. They didn't have Facebook. They didn't have email. Yet they were able to be effective concerning the charge, the great commission that Jesus had given them in Matthew 28, to go ye therefore. And I'm just like, how did they do it? You know, I really think it's because the disciples really understood Jesus' example and God's way and heart for people. I believe they really grasped God's heart for people, and because of that, they were able to be effective in their actions. So I'm being honest, I'm not there yet. So that's why we are reinforcing these teachings. Amen? And maybe you're like me and you need this to be reinforced. So that's what we're going to do today. So, you know, in order for us to do that, though, and what my message is going to talk about is that I think we need to make a shift. We need to make a shift in the way that we think about God's people. We need to shift the way that we think about this world. We need to shift the way that we think about the lost, the people that are out there that we're praying for. So before I talk about shifting and get ahead of myself, let's go to Matthew 28. Matthew 28. Amen. Amen. I'm glad that the Lord's word is blessed. Amen. Matthew 28, and we're going to start at verse 16. I'm going to read it out of the King James Version. Amen. So it says, "Then the 11 disciples went away into Galilee, into a mountain where Jesus had appointed them. And when they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, All power is given unto me in heaven and earth. Go ye, therefore, and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world." So what we're talking about right before we get started in the shift is, what is our job? What is our responsibility? This is our job. This is our responsibility. This is the Great Commission, to go ye therefore. In the Amplified, in verse 19, it even says, go therefore and make disciples of all nations. And it says, help the people to learn of me. Help the people to learn of me, believe in me, and obey my words. Help the people to learn of me, learn of who God is, believe in him, and obey his words. So that is the Great Commission. That's the charge. Let's turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 7. We're going to keep moving. We're going to establish this foundation, and then we're just going to roll. Amen? Amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 17. And I'm going to read it out of the Amplified first. 7:17. Again, what is our job? So 17 says, only let each one live the life which the Lord has assigned him. Live the life which the Lord has assigned him. We have an assignment, people of God, and to which God has called him. For each person is unique and is accountable for his choices and conduct. Let him walk in this way. This is the rule I make in all the churches. So again, we have a great commission in Matthew 28. We also have an assignment. And if you turn to the message, it really puts it in home, especially with what we were talking about last week in terms of us being on our different jobs and, you know, we have a ministry at our marketplace. 7:17 in the message says, and don't be wishing you were someplace else or with someone else. Don't be wishing that you're at some other job or some other place. Where you are right now is God's place for you. Where you are. That's a word for somebody today. Where you are right now is God's place for you. Live and obey and love and believe right there. So we have a great commission. We have an assignment, and your assignment is exactly where you are today. Amen? Amen. Let's turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Amen. You have an assignment, and it's exactly where you are. Don't be wishing you somewhere else. Amen? Amen. I know we want to. I struggle with that as well. But where you are, that's why God placed you there. So 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, I'm going to read it out of the NLT. It says, and we know this means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone, a new life has begun. And all of this is a gift from God who brought us back to himself through Christ. And God has given us the task of reconciling people to him. For God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, no longer counting people's sins against them. And he gave us this wonderful message of reconciliation. And then here's verse 20. So we are Christ's ambassadors. We are Christ's ambassadors. God is making his appeal through us. We speak for Christ when we plead, come back to God. That's what we're saying when we are speaking to the lost. Come back to God. For God made Christ who never sinned to be an offering for our sin so that we may be made right with God through Christ. That is our job. That is our responsibility. The Great Commission to go ye therefore. You have an assignment. It's exactly where you are. And you are God's ambassadors. Amen? Amen. And let's read it out of the message. Because, I like it because it's going to just tee us up from where I'm going. In the message, verse 16 of 2 Corinthians 5, it says, because of this decision, we don't evaluate people by what they have or how they look. Amen. Just get that in your spirit. We don't evaluate people by what they have or how they look. We looked at the Messiah that way once and got it all wrong, you know. We certainly don't look at him that way anymore. Now we look inside. This is teaching us. This is showing us how to be effective ambassadors. We look inside. And what we see is that anyone who is united with the Messiah gets a fresh start, is created new. The old life is gone, and a new life burgeons. Look at it. All this comes from God who settled the relationship between us and him. Amen. And then called us to settle our relationships with each other. Amen. Amen. God put the world square with himself through the Messiah, giving the world a fresh start by offering forgiveness of sins. And God has given us this task of telling everyone else what he's doing. We are Christ's representatives. God uses us to persuade men and women to drop their differences and enter into God's work of making things right between them. Amen. Amen. That is our job. That is our job. That is our responsibility. The Great commissioned. You have been assigned. You have an assignment exactly where you are. You are Christ's ambassadors, and you're supposed to be appealing to people not based on how they look, but based on what's inside of them. Amen? Because we already know that in 1 Timothy, we can turn there real quick too, and then we're just going to go. 1 Timothy chapter 2. We already know what God's heart is for people, what God's desire is for people. 1 Timothy 2, starting at verse 1 out of the NLT, it says, I urge you, first of all, to pray for all people. Ask God to help them. Intercede on their behalf and give thanks for them. Pray this way for kings and for all who are in authority so that we can all live peaceful and quiet lives marked by godliness and dignity. And it says, this is good and pleases God, our Savior, who, verse 4, who wants everyone to be saved and to understand the truth. God loves people, and he wants everyone to be saved and understand the truth. And the responsibility is ours as Christ's representatives. Amen. Amen. We have a great commission. We have an assignment. We are Christ's ambassadors to win souls because God desires for every single person to be saved and understand the truth. And how do they understand? They understand it through us helping them learn of God and believe in him and believe in this word. Amen. Amen. But as I said earlier, the problem is I think we need to shift our perception of people in this world that make up those souls. Amen? Amen. So to shift, if we can pull up the definition of shift, to shift, it means to change or to cause something to change, to have a different opinion or belief. It's the first slide. Amen. To shift means to change or to cause something to change to a different opinion or belief. Or it is to move. It's to cause something to move to a different place. Amen. You can write it down. It's to shift means to change or to cause something to change to a different opinion or a different belief. Amen. And people of God, the message today is we need to have a paradigm. Amen. There it is. A paradigm shift when it comes to souls. Amen. We need to have a paradigm shift because we need to share our faith effectively, and we need to share our faith with people that God loves. So what is a paradigm? A paradigm means a model. It is a theory. Highlighted, it is a perception. It is an assumption. It is a frame of reference. That's what a paradigm is. It's just a model. It's just a frame of reference. It's how we understand the world, how we see the world. Not in terms of visual sight, but by perceiving, by understanding, by interpreting, how we analyze what we see in the world. So let me make it even more plain. Let's pull up the picture, the map of Chicago. So this is a map of Chicago. This is a model. This is a representation. Is this Chicago? No, this is not Chicago actually, right? This is just a model. This is a representation. Amen. Of Chicago. This is not Chicago, but it is a representation. It is one person's representation of Chicago. This map shows some features, right? So let's pull up the second map of Chicago. This is also a map of Chicago, but it looks different, right? But this shows different features, different aspects of Chicago. This is showing specific communities, while the other one was more detailed in terms of roads and streets. So which one is right? Yeah, they both are models. They are both representations of Chicago, emphasizing or showing different aspects. But each one is limited or different in their individual focus. All right, y'all getting it? Amen, amen, stay with me. So why maps? Why maps? We all have mental maps about everything that we see in the world. And the thing is, we individually assume that the way that we see things is the way that they are. Or the way that it should be. Or the way that everybody else should think. And we don't even realize that that's just our individual mental map. And that's not necessarily the truth. And the thing is, we have these mental maps. We seldom even question the accuracy of our mental maps. We just say, oh, it's true because this is what's inside of me. Amen. We seldom question it. We have these maps, and it's like we don't even realize when somebody disagrees with us, we just think, oh, they're wrong. We're not even understanding that it could possibly be another way of seeing things. Amen. Amen. You getting it? Amen. So the paradigm, it's just the model. It's not the actual thing. And the problem becomes when our individual paradigm is not completely in line with the Word of God, amen, then our perception is distorted. That's when our perception becomes distorted, when we are not in line with the Word of God, amen? And when if we want to see real change concerning souls, we can't go to the surface. We got to go to the root. We got to go to those basic paradigms that we all have and align them with the Word of God. Amen. All right. So think about, here's another illustration. Think about glasses. These are my glasses. Yes, I wear contacts because these are whatever. I'm not walking around in these. So these are my glasses. So raise your hand if you have 20/20 vision without any aid or assistance or anything. All right. So praise the Lord. Some of y'all debating, I don't know. So, okay, let's assume that 20/20 vision, because I'm not an optometrist, so I don't really know if that's exact or whatever. Let's say 20/20 vision is the most perfect vision. Let's just say that's the most perfect vision. Let's say that that's like the Word of God. Word of God is perfect. Amen. It's true. There's nothing better. There's nothing, you know, whatever. So the Word of God is perfect. That's 20/20 vision. So if I took one of you that raised your hand and that said you had perfect vision, gave you my glasses, because I remember this always used to happen on the playground when I was little, gave you my glasses and had you put them on, what you could saw before, which was perfectly clear, would now become blurry. Amen. Your vision is distorted. Because the thing is, whenever we try to add aid or assistance to something that is already perfect, amen, you run into problems. The Word of God is already perfect. And the thing is, we are putting our little lenses over the perfect Word of God, and we're wondering why our vision is distorted. Amen? Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. When you try to correct something that's already perfect, and the Word of God is infallible, it is perfect, it is full of principles that are always true and apply to every situation. We don't need to correct it with our own paradigms, but that's what we do. And if you can pull up just some of those pictures of the different vision and how your vision is distorted, like if you're nearsighted, this is what you see and that's the actual truth. And just pull up the other two pictures as well. And you see like 20/20 vision, you could see down there. And then if your vision is worse, it becomes blurry. This is what happens. This is how some of us are seeing. This is how we see the world, and we're wondering why we're not winning souls. Can you pull up the picture of the sketch drawing? So look at this picture. Tell me, what do you see? How many of you say you see an old lady? Raise your hand. How many of y'all say y'all see a young lady? Amen. Y'all both right. Amen. Because this could be like the chin of a young woman, or it could be the nose of an old lady. So again, we can look at the same picture, and this would be her mouth. Amen. Y'all can look it up on Google today. I don't want y'all to get tripped up, but you can see it can be an old woman or it can be a young woman, depending on how you look at it. Y'all getting it? All right. So technically, hey, don't get lost in the weeds. Technically, y'all are both right. But the thing is, I don't know who the artist was trying to draw. I don't know if the artist was trying to draw an old woman or a young woman. We can just guess, like, oh, he maybe was trying to draw an old woman. I don't know. But the thing is, we don't have to guess with the word of God. We know exactly what God is telling us to do and how God wants us to treat the world and the people in it. Amen. Because what happens is that when we all wear certain lenses, whether you realize it or not, and they're helping you shape and interpret what you see in the world. And unfortunately, those lenses sometimes distort the word of God. And I believe that's why we have seen the setbacks in terms of souls. So let us, before I even get into that, you know, if you see somebody in a certain way, you think your attitude and your behavior towards that person will be affected, right? If you see somebody in a certain way, your attitude and behavior will be affected. So can you pull up those pictures and just play each one for about 5 seconds? Look at these images of these people. You probably already have a built-in perception, and you can just keep them rolling. You probably already have a built-in perception without even talking to those people about who those people are, what they believe in, what they're about. You know, we all have our own individual, you know, mental maps that are already playing when we see each of those people. And if you see somebody in a certain way, you know, that's how you may treat them. And the thing is, we think we're being rational, we think we're being objective, but at the end of the day, we are seeing people through how we are conditioned to see them. Through whatever means, through our backgrounds, through our experiences, through our family, through the media. And if we open our mouths to describe what we saw in all of those pictures, it's actually showing us what's inside of us. It's showing us our own perceptions and how we even see ourselves. And when, you know, and we just seen that we can all be sincere and clear-headed people and we could still see the same picture differently. Amen. Just like we saw with the woman, we can look at the same picture and see something different, and we could all be right. You know, I was watching about a month ago the movie Inside Out, the animated movie, and it was, many of you saw that, where it was talking about a little girl that was moving, and you saw inside her body, you saw the different emotions. Each one was a different character showing how she was feeling, like sadness and joy and disgust and fear and anger. And the thing was, they would replay different events in her life, and depending on the event, each emotion would have a different view or perception of that same event. So like there was one time where she was like playing in the water, and joy was like, oh, it was so much fun, we were jumping on the puddles and it was such a great time. Sadness was like, oh, the water's in my boots and I was squishing everywhere and it was just, I got water everywhere. Same event, but two totally different perceptions. That's what we have to understand is that we can't have a different perception of people that's opposite to the word of God. Amen. Jesus had compassion on people. We need to have that same compassion. Amen. Turn to Matthew 9. Amen. Turn to Matthew 9. We need to have the same compassion that God has. Jesus demonstrated the love that God had for people when he walked this earth. Amen. Amen. Let's turn to Matthew 9:36. Amen. I'm just doing my setup. We need to get moving. Amen. Amen. Chapter 9:36. I'm going to read out a New Living Translation. It says, when he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them, because they were confused and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. And he said to his disciples, the harvest is great, but the workers are few. So pray to the Lord who is in charge of the harvest, ask him to send more workers into his field. Thing is, there are so many believers in the land. There should not be a lack in terms of winning souls, amen? But I think the problem is that so many believers' perception has been distorted, so they don't, one, understand they have an assignment, and two, they don't understand who their assignment is to, amen? Because their vision is distorted. So we all wear different lenses, and I got some different lenses. Each one, you put them on, it distorts how you see something. Amen. Different colored lenses distort how you see some. These are just broke. Some of our lenses are broke. That's why I wasn't even going to bring this one up here. Some of y'all, you know, it's already broken. So we're just gonna talk about a few different lenses that we all wear that distort our mission and our great commission of going ye therefore. So first kind of lens you could be wearing is a poverty or a lack lens. You can write that down, a poverty or a lack lens. What happens when you're wearing a poverty lens? So doesn't matter how many messages we hear about giving, doesn't matter how many times we quote Malachi 3, every time you hear that message, it's distorted through your poverty lens that you're not going to have enough if you give 10%. Amen. It's distorting God's perfect law of giving. Amen. When you put your poverty lens on, you're seeing things through lack. You know, and that's why Jesus told us, I think it was in Mark 14:7, that the poor is going to be with us always. He knew that there would always be people that would always see things through a poverty lens of, I don't have enough. And all of these lessons, the disciples had to struggle and deal with these lessons as well. Because disciples had to struggle, they also struggled with a lack or a poverty lens. I'm not going to turn there, but if you go to Matthew 14 or Mark 8, where it talks about the counts where Jesus fed the 5,000 plus and the 4,000 plus, the disciples had to deal with that because, like in Matthew 4:15, disciples came to Jesus and said, well, this is a remote place, it's getting late, send the crowds away so they can go to the villages, buy food for themselves. And Jesus was like, this isn't necessary, you feed them. And they're like, we only got 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. They were seeing things through poverty or lack, not seeing things through God's word, of the abundant word of God. Amen, that he is a God of abundance and no lack. You know, even in Mark 8, Jesus said, I feel sorry for these people. We need God's heart. This is God's heart for people. I feel sorry for these people. They have been here with me for 3 days and they have nothing to eat. If I send them home hungry now, they'll faint along the way. For some of them have come such a long distance. And the disciples were like, well, how are we supposed to feed them? And again, we don't have enough food. And then Jesus still showed them. He had to confront their lens. So they had to do a paradigm shift. And you may think, okay, what does this have to do? What does poverty have to do with sharing your faith? Well, it has everything to do, because if you're operating under a poverty lens, you are not willing to give unto others that are needy. And that is a good and perfect evangelistic tool. We know all about Heaven's Agenda. We hear it every month. When you address somebody's basic human need, they're going to be more apt to listen to you about getting their spiritual needs met. Amen. If somebody's hungry and you just give them a Bible, that's not going to be as effective as you give them some food and then give them the Bible. Because then they're going to say, who is this God that you serve that allows you to have more than enough? That's your opening. That's your opening to share your faith. Amen. Amen. And also when you're operating under lack, you can't give freely to support the ministry. You can't give cheerfully. And that's our job. That's our assignment. So that's one of the lenses. And the second lens that some people, especially African Americans, have is a slavery lens. A slavery lens. They see everything through this lens of past slavery. You know, every person in authority is the man. Or even people who are not even in authority, but who they perceive to be in authority because of that lens. So all white people are the man. When you're operating on that lens, you might as well just call them master, because that's what you're doing, basically. And what was master? Master only let you go so far. Master only allow you to get so much. And if you're seeing people through that way, how can you effectively minister to them? If you see every person that's white or whatever in this domineering position of power over you, how apt are you going to be to step out and share your faith with that person? Or are you going to be insecure and you're going to think, well, I don't have anything to offer that person because they already are above me? No, Jesus is Lord. He's the only Lord that is above us. Amen? And there are different levels of authority here on earth that we must follow and conform to. But a lot of us are placing other people in authority that aren't really over authority over your life. And you have something to offer that person that you perceive to already have it all. Amen? Amen. Another, so that's the second lens, slavery lens. Another lens that we sometimes struggle with, that I know myself I struggle with sometimes, is a fear lens. Fear lens. I used to be a very scary child. You know, I slept with the light on really until I was about to go to college. Like, my mom was like, you gotta learn how to sleep with the light off and whatever. You know, I used to be scared of my basement. I used to be scared of clowns, still kind of whatever. Clowns, stuff like that. And sometimes, they don't look right all the time. They always look happy, but no. And sometimes I have to catch myself, and because otherwise I'll see everything through that fear lens, you know? Like, everything that I see, my initial reaction will be one of fear. Even like when we were going to Beirut last year, my initial reaction was fear. Like, I'm not going there, you know? That's for somebody else or whatever. But then I had to focus my eyes. I had to focus my eyes on the perfect 2020 vision of the Word of God. First to realize God has not given us a spirit of fear, but a power, love, and a sound mind. But then also to know that He has given me this great commission to go ye therefore. So he's actually endorsing this. So the thing is, a lot of times fear will play in with our different personality types. You know, like, you're an introvert, you know, and you don't like to talk to other people and you like to be quiet by yourself. That's a lens that you're putting on because it's distorting Matthew 28 for you. Because you're thinking, oh, I want to go, but, you know, this is just the way I am. This was how I was made. My personality type, you know, won't allow me to talk to other people that I don't know. There ain't nothing I can do about that. This is just how I am. That's fear and that's a lie. Because God would never tell us to do something that He hasn't already equipped us to do. Amen? So you're just operating under fear lens that's distorting the authority and the power that you have to share your faith. The thing is, with your personality, that may be your natural inclination, but that's just showing you how you need to maneuver around it. Once you know that about yourself, then you make steps to maneuver around that. Amen. That's just the beginning to understand how you're going to communicate effectively with people. But the thing is, if we have to be proactive about it and not reactive and just say, well, this is just me. The lens of fear. The disciples dealt with the lens of fear. You can write this down. Mark chapter 4. Mark 4, that's when Jesus was like, we need to get on this boat, go to the other side. And the disciples were like, okay, you know, whatever. They got on the boat. Jesus went on the boat, went to sleep. The water started getting all rough, and, you know, and the disciples started to get scared, like, why you got us out here, you know, about to die? They were operating under a fear lens. Because, I mean, really, if you think about it, Jesus was on the boat with them. If Jesus is on your boat, how the boat gonna sink? But that fear lens was distorting the truth of who God was. That's why Jesus was like, calm the wind, calm the storm down, and, you know, you need some more faith, disciples. We are His disciples as well. We need some more faith. Amen. I understand fear of rejection. It is difficult to put yourself out there to somebody that you don't know how they're going to receive whatever you got to say. But the thing is, you know, Jesus dealt with the most rejection that any human person could ever experience. That's right. And He's our example. So we can do it. Amen. Amen. The last lens I wanted to talk about was a hopelessness lens. Wow. Hopelessness lens. When you're wearing this lens of hopelessness, especially when it concerns souls, you look out into this world, all you see are heathens. That's all you see. Everybody going to hell. Ain't nobody can be saved. There's no redemption. Wow. You know, oh, they won't ever get it. You forget about yourself, how you got saved. Yeah. But, you know, everybody else is just lost causes. Youth, oh, they all lost. Ain't nobody living right. Ain't nobody doing anything right. When you have that lens, that keeps you from sharing your faith. Because if you know something is hopeless going in, how confident, how bold are you going to be to actually share your faith? You know, you're going to be quiet. And even if you push past that initial, you know, thing that's going to stop you from sharing your faith, even if you push past that and share your faith, how effective are you going to be? Just think about it. When you have like a winning argument, like think about your spouse or with your children or with somebody else, when you know you're right about something, think about how confident you are, how bold you are in that argument. I know, you came home at such and such time and you got it all together. You are confident. But think about it when you got kind of a little shady kind of, you know, argument. Your argument's kind of lacking a lot, you know. If you got something kind of shady, you could still be bold, but it's kind of hard for you to be confident and bold and be like, I know, you know, you're going to be a little more reserved about it. And the thing is, we can be confident concerning winning souls because this is God's heart. We don't have to come into this tentatively. We can be confident, and if you're going to be more convincing when you're confident. Amen? So that's why we have to do the shift. We need a paradigm shift. We have to change our perception so that it is aligned with the Word of God. Amen. So I just talked about a few different lenses. You could be wearing completely other different lenses, but think about that today. Examine yourself. Think about that. Even with the lens of hopelessness, there's also a little offshoot of that, and that's a lens of waste of time. Lens of waste of time. The disciples dealt with that. You can write down Matthew 15, verse 21, and read through that passage. And that was when a woman was coming to Jesus and, you know, trying to get his attention. Jesus didn't say anything. And the disciples urged him to send her away. He said, tell her to go away. They said, she is bothering us. She is bothering us with all her begging. But then Jesus, he had compassion on her and he healed her. That's God's heart for people. That's what we need to be aligned with. You know, also think in the Bible all the times when parents were bringing their children to Jesus so that he can bless them and touch them. And the disciples would scold the parents talking about, oh, you bothering them with all these little children. No, Jesus blessed all of them. It wasn't a waste of time, even though it wasn't necessarily on his scheduled routine for that day. Y'all ain't getting it. On your schedule routine. I'm a person of routine. I like everything. I write it out, map out my day. And any deviation from that routine, it almost seems like it's ungodly. It's like, oh, God knew I had my plan, you know, whatever. But it shows us that Jesus deviated from his routine, and that was godly. Because he was saving souls. He was healing people. He had compassion on people. We need to love God, love people the way that God loves people. Amen? Amen. 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 We can't, like all those images we looked at earlier, we can't say, well, I'm not going to waste my time on her because she's wearing a sari, so she's probably a Muslim, so she ain't going to receive. Or I ain't going to waste my time on her because she got all this goth makeup on. She's a Satanist. She ain't going to receive. These are the judgments. Amen. Am I sounding familiar to you? I ain't going to waste my time on him. You know, he my boss. He a white man. He got it all. He don't need to hear this message. I'm gonna keep just doing my job. This is what we do, amen? Paradigm shifts, this is what we need to make. So, and the thing is, it's a process, and I'm trying to get into my clothes, but it's a process for us to paradigm shift, to make these shifts, because these have been years and years, some of us have been conditioned to look at people in a certain way, to have these built up perceptions about people. And the shift comes when we see things the way that God wants us to see them. And, you know, and that's why Jesus said, be as little children. Little children, they don't have all those years and years built up of all these different lenses that they're carrying and that's distorting the vision of the Word of God. That's how they're able to see the Word of God and receive it clearly, often quickly. And that's how we have to be. And I really believe that the souls that we're looking for, the diversity that I know is upon this house will come as a result of us really understanding this message. Amen? Amen? Amen. In order for us to effectively share our faith, we have to be transformed by the Word of God. Amen. We know Romans 12:2, it says, and be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may know what is good and acceptable and the perfect will of God. In Ephesians 5:26, it tells us that we have to continuously wash ourselves with the water of the Word. How many of you just take one shower and you good for the week? Hopefully not, none of y'all. Now, I feel bad if you sit next to somebody that thinks that way. You wash daily. We have to wash daily with this Word of God because we got to wipe out all of those distortions that are distorting the Word of God for us. Let's turn to one more scripture. Let's turn to Matthew chapter 6. Matthew chapter 6. Amen. Are y'all getting this message?
Amen.
Amen. Matthew chapter 6, verse 23. I'm going to read it out of the Amplified. Amen. I want you to see this. And it says, the eye is the lamp, lamp of the body. Verse 22, actually. The eye is the lamp of the body. So if your eye is clear, spiritually perceptive, your whole body will be full of light, benefiting from God's precepts. But verse 23, but if your eye is bad, if it's spiritually blind, your whole body will be full of darkness and devoid of God's precepts. So if the very light inside of you, your inner self, your heart, your conscience, is darkness, how great and terrible is that darkness? And people of God, we have to understand how important our sight is when it concerns souls. We have to understand that if our sight is jacked up, not only are we going to be ineffective concerning winning souls, our own lives are probably ineffective. Because how we see people is really how we see ourselves. Amen. And our character, that is a composite of our habits. Everything that we do without even thinking about it, that is our character. And so it's not a surprise that we're still teaching and we're still learning on sharing our faith, because until this becomes a habit for all of us, it has not changed our character. It takes time to break up all of those things like selfishness and impatience and being judgmental. It requires tremendous effort and time. We have to see things from God's point of view. Can we pull up one more scripture? I just want to show this. Mark chapter 8. Just want to show how the disciples had to have these paradigm shifts. Every day with Jesus was a paradigm shift for them. He was transforming the way they saw everything. And that's how this word should be for us. Matthew 8:31, NLT, said Jesus predicted his death, that he would suffer many things, be rejected by elders, priests, and teachers of religious law. And Peter took him aside and began to reprimand him. And Jesus turned around and looked at his disciples, and then he reprimanded Peter. He said, "Get away from me, Satan," he said. "You are seeing things merely from a human point of view, not from God's." You are seeing things merely from a human point of view, not from God's. That's what we do when we wear the different lenses that we wear. We're seeing things not the way that God wants us to see things. We are seeing people not the way God wants us to see people. He desires that all people be saved. And Isaiah 55, you don't have to turn there, 8 and 9 tells us, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways, my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts." The thing is, we need to have God's thoughts. We need to have his ways concerning souls. Amen. Lift up your hands. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I just thank you. I thank you and I praise you, God, right now for this word. I thank you, Lord God, that you are awakening us, Lord God, to see people the way that you see people. That you are breaking up all seeds of selfishness, of racism, of rejection, of fear, that have been built up for many years and years in our minds, that you are redesigning our mental maps and conforming them to your word, God. We thank you that the same compassion that Jesus had for people as he walked the earth, we would have that same compassion, that we would look at people and not already judge them and not already write them out, but we would follow Holy Spirit's guidance concerning evangelism, amen, concerning sharing our faith. We thank you, Lord God, that you have given us an assignment and that we have something to offer, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, that you have called us as your ambassadors, Lord God, hallelujah, into this world. And we thank you, Lord God, that every place that we step, every place that our footsteps upon has already been given to us, that we have authority and power to change systems, to change environments, and to change people's lives. Hallelujah, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, Father God, that the Spirit of living God is living within us and rising within us right now, lifting up our head and lifting us up to the assignment that you have placed in our hearts, Lord God. We want your heart, Lord God. Hallelujah. We want your heart, Lord. We want your heart concerning souls. Hallelujah. Tear up anything within us, Lord God. Hallelujah. That has been contrary to your heart, Lord. We ask for forgiveness right now, Lord. Hallelujah. And we just thank you, Lord God. Hallelujah. That because we are here, there is purpose inside of us, and we still have work to do. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap for the word.